be on this one, huh? Okay. I thought there was nothing new under the sun, but I was wrong. This is all new for me.
Steve, who's your first witness?
Amanda Padilla by Zoom.
Okay. And then?
Let me go look.
Okay.
It's the same.
The same order? Are
yeah.
they all here?
Well, in a virtual sense of the word. Joseph is here. Lisa isn't here yet. Larry's Zoom. Denise is here. Sylvan, Scott, and Roxanne are Zoom, and then Michelle. Coleman, so I did take in this. You might.
I forwarded the link to your email. Did you send him the link?
The one that you sent didn't have a link, so I sent you an email because you. Oh, and I tried to go in, I couldn't add.
I did forward the ones you guys sent.
Oh, you did?
Uh huh. To Fabian and to Steve. And I gave him a note that he was supposed to come in the Google Meet, not the Zoom.
He thinks he's squared away, but I don't know.
I don't know.
I sent you his email address.
Okay.
Which is littleluna2019@yahoo. I can write down. I don't know if that'll help somehow. But.
Not in yet.
may be seated.
Stating in Mexico versus Fabian Gonzales, CR 2016-2961.
James Grayson and Chris Daly for the state of New Mexico.
Steve Barron and Hugh Dangler for the defendant.
Is he on? I can't see that far away.
I can't. I don't know. I don't see him, but.
Yeah, there he is.
Okay, good. Thank you. All right, a couple things I wanted to discuss before we got started. Since we broke, I've been sort of working on this issue about waiving the defendant's appearance and thinking about other options we might have at this point. Because what I don't want to do is go forward to trial and we find that it's an issue with him not being here in person. So I want to check in with the defense. Is there any, would your client be willing to waive his in-person appearance based on how we sort of configure things now?
He's indicated no, but he does not waive his appearance, his right to defend himself in person. For the record, the court already knows we both tested negative. The defendant is symptomatic, but and running a 102 or 101.9. If it gets to 103, he has to go to the hospital. Also, I should say that there were some communications during the trial. The way we would do it is that Fabian would tell Maurice and he would type it on his laptop and I would be looking at it. So we were communicating in our own way. But there's a lot of merit to the system, I guess. I mean, it's not ideal. I should also point out that there were times when the defendant was sitting next to me when Maurice left to pick up transcripts or whatever. We didn't want to leave an empty chair, so he would sit next to me. I'm concerned about that. I wasn't asked the five questions downstairs, so I didn't mislead anyone. And I don't know what contact means. I mean, I'm negative. Maybe that's good enough for the system. I don't know. But those are the issues.
So
the other thing, Judge, before I finish, is the Sixth Amendment and Article 2 do say confronted with the witnesses against him, and I couldn't find anything for or against the notion that a witness called by the defense can be mixed. Some of it can be for and against him. I don't know if any case has held that right doesn't apply. I did notice that I believe it's Article 2, the New Mexico Constitution says the right to defend himself in person. But I totally understand the court's extraordinary efforts, and we want to conclude this too. So, I mean, we rely on the court, but we're not waiving those issues.
So the rule I'm concerned with is 5612. And so we're going to talk a little bit with your client about, let me pull up the rule here. I can just get Westlaw open. Provided by these rules, the defendant shall be present at all proceedings, including arraignment, all hearings and conferences, argument, the jury trial and during all communications between the court and the trial jury. B, waiver of personal appearance. The defendant may waive the right to be personally present, one, for a specific hearing or proceeding by an oral waiver on the record, or two, by executing a waiver substantially in the form approved by the Supreme Court. Paragraph C, continued presence not required. The further progress of the trial, including the return of the verdict and the imposition of sentence, shall not be prevented if the defendant waives the right to be personally present or whenever a defendant who was initially present, one, is voluntarily absent after the trial has commenced, or two, engages in conduct which the court determines by clear and convincing evidence to be so disruptive as to justify the exclusion of the defendant from further proceedings. So I want to make an inquiry, and you can take the time if you need to, Mr. Aarons and Mr. Dangler, to speak with your client as to what sort of precautions your client took to make sure he was not contracting COVID to result in exactly the situation we're in right now, because I think that that is an important consideration, especially for paragraph C2 of 5612. So if you want to take that moment to call him and have that conversation, or if you want him to, I'm not sure how you want to handle that.
Okay, Judge, could you read me again? That's the concern.
So basically, it says engages, so the presence of the defendant is not required if he engages in conduct which the court determines by clear and convincing evidence to be so disruptive as to justify the exclusion of the defendant. So from my perspective, it would be clear and convincing evidence that his behavior was disruptive in the sense that he engaged in activities in the midst of his trial that likely exposed him to COVID, or he didn't take adequate precautions, like I'm sure all of us have been, to make sure we don't contract COVID in the middle of this trial. That's what I'm looking for.
I'll speak with him.
Thank you.
Your Honor, on that point, I believe the defendant is monitored by GPS, so pretrial services could also provide Your Honor those records.
Okay. And before you do that, so that we can consolidate this conversation, Mr. Dangler?
Yes.
I am currently trying to get approval from the Supreme Court right now to allow the defendant present in the courtroom under certain circumstances. And it's up to the Supreme Court. If they say no, we can't do it.
Right.
So I don't know if the parties have noticed in the hallway on the fourth floor, there's those glass boxes. Have you seen those? They're like meeting rooms, but they're all glass. That we can move one of those boxes into the courtroom, put it far away from everybody, have the defendant enter the courthouse early in the morning when there's not as many people present, by himself, ride the elevator by himself, double KN95 masked, sit in the box with an air purifier and his double mask on. Then he's personally present. That's my another option I'm looking at, but again, it's going to be up to the Supreme Court if they agree with, if they allow it. If they don't allow it, we can't pursue that. So that's something you'll want to talk to your client about as well.
Great.
Okay? Yeah. Go ahead and take that time.
Thank you.
hear us, Fabian?
Just give us a thumbs up.
Can you hear us? Thumbs up if you can hear us.
Okay. Can we hear him?
No, I believe he's muted.
Okay. So Judge, how would you like to proceed? Would you like me to tell you what he said? Because I'm fine to do that.
Whatever, I mean,
and then
whatever
you can ask questions.
Yeah, whatever you think is relevant to my two inquiries.
Okay. I have a bunch that's relevant.
Okay.
Okay, so pretty much he's been avoiding people because of the notoriety of this thing. He's been trying to avoid confrontations with people. He has driven to the grocery store, but he stayed in the truck while his wife went in to get groceries. On weekends, he has picked up his son from where his son lives with the mother, and had his son with him, and then left the son again. I don't know where that is, Judge, so, but that could be tracked by his GPS. He's been to one restaurant. They went to a restaurant called Carpos. They sat away from other people. No one in the family got sick, including apparently his wife. His wife tested negative. I thought she also had COVID. She doesn't. The restaurant trip, I think, took place in the last few days. Also, the emergency room. We know about the emergency room trip. Let's see. So I don't know where the grocery store is, but that should be tracked. Basically, he's been trying to avoid being in public places because of the notoriety. He said even in the restaurant, it was all over the TV sets. So pretty much he's been doing what normal people do. It seems like he's not running around, he's not going to the downs, he's not, you know, trying to get in crowds, he definitely wasn't doing behaviors to try to get COVID. What else can I tell you? He does really want to be in court. He's okay with the glass box if you're able to do that. I'm a little concerned because right now, he's run a fever as high as 102.9, and the doctors told him, you get 103, you go to the hospital. So at any time, he may have to just leave and go somewhere else to the emergency room. And he is feeling really lousy. It's hard for him to concentrate. It's very hard for him to follow what's going on.
And I texted and called the 102.9 that they just took. So there's a picture of it that I sent to your DCAA.
All right, well, I have to wait back to hear from the Supreme Court on that issue. Hopefully we'll hear pretty soon. So we can start to explore the option of talking to the jury. Ms. Salcedo has not returned and is not returning calls. She's not answering her phone. So she's one of our alternates. That is alternate 3 at this point. So we can bring in the jury and talk to them a little bit about coming back next week and see what people's availability is. And then also, I wanted to see what defense, if you have any other ideas, since your client's not willing to waive, we are more than two-thirds of the way through this trial. And you know, the other consideration is that, you know, if we have to do this trial all over again, there's no telling when COVID is going to be resolved. So, you know, just playing devil's advocate here, even if we reset this, you know, as soon as possible, there's, you know, COVID's still going to be around and we're probably going to have the same issues coming up. It may depend on who's going to contract it, but we can be fairly certain someone's going to contract COVID during a three-week period. So, defense, do you have any other ideas than the ones I suggested?
I don't. He feels pretty strongly that he wants to be here. It's his liberty that's on the line, and I can understand that. I think the 1 week is a good option. I know with somebody else who got pretty bad, the medicine started kicking in after a day or two, and you know, most people do okay. I'm a little worried that he's right on the borderline of being admitted. And that it just, I've never been in this situation, so I don't have any good solutions for the court. And I agree, COVID may not go away. We lost one juror who had COVID symptoms, and this is happening. I know that a journalist may have gotten it last week. I didn't hear the confirmation, but so I don't have. He's the glass box would be an option to satisfy the in person, and at least he could see everything that's going on, and we could text and things. I'm just concerned that he's not physically able. If you hear his voice, you'll understand what I'm talking about. But I don't know if he's able to go forward. But I agree. I mean, we were, in fairness, if we didn't call him, it would be not because of COVID. But we're on the last day of evidence, I think.
Right.
And we're all as disappointed as the court.
I mean, your client's aware of what would occur if jurors can't come back and he won't wait, then the Supreme Court won't agree to let him in the courthouse. He's aware of the consequences?
He is aware, Judge. Yeah. And he has waited 6 years, so if he has to wait longer, he has to wait longer. And I think no one's told him, oh, this will be great for speedy trial, because it won't. It's COVID. It has nothing to do with speedy trial. So it's not going to change. It's not going to change that situation. I think he understands that, but he feels strongly about it. I mean, he feels strongly about having his family in court, and I've told him that's a dead issue. But that's how he feels.
Your Honor, the state understands the court's concerns with Rule 5612. We had those concerns as well. That's why I presented the court with People v. Whitmore this morning, because there is still a prejudice inquiry, even under that rule. That rule is actually based on Supreme Court precedent. It's from Taylor v. United States, 414 U.S. 17, 1973, a per curiam opinion that followed the opinion in Illinois v. Allen. And the court said there that the governmental prerogative to proceed with the trial may not be defeated by conduct of the accused that prevents the trial from going forward once it has been initiated. So in terms of the record on the point of being voluntarily absent, I think the state would like an opportunity to investigate that matter to see what conduct, or at least what movements.
I can get his records. Almost immediately.
Thank you, Your Honor. The state would like to investigate that. And even beyond that, as I mentioned earlier, this is extraordinary circumstances. And I think the prejudice inquiry in People v. Whitmore is instructive. The court said there that because virtual equipment is so good right now, and we've experienced that during COVID, we've had virtual proceedings during COVID. Some trials in parts of the state have been virtual. On agreement of the parties. And so we do have exceptional technology now that comes very close to being the same as being physically present. And so, although those are the terms of the rules, in this extraordinary situation, I think there could be an exception due to a lack of prejudice. And in terms of the box that Your Honor mentioned, the state has no issue with that.
Yeah. Just the risk is so great to go forward in the face of 5612 for everybody to have some, you know, sort of closure on this case only for it to be reversed on appeal. That's a really, really big risk for everybody. And so I want to make sure we're being, you know, as thoughtful as we can about this, because we are in extraordinary times. I mean, there's no question about it. And there aren't, if we haven't been in it long enough to have any case law that would guide us on whether this is sufficient. And so this could potentially be the case that would tell us if it's sufficient. And I don't want it to be. You know, I don't want that for anybody. And so that's why I'm trying to think if there's anything else we can do. And so I'm having the coordinates obtained right now from Marshall Dixon. We'll get that. I'm wondering if we want to pursue Ms. Saucedo, because I'm happy to try and call her as well. Or if we want to just release her, bring in the jury, we can have the state rest, and then talk to them a little bit about scheduling so that we're sort of working multiple angles at a time. What do you guys think?
I think that makes sense, Your Honor, at least to make the inquiry of the jury, and then we can think about it further, and Your Honor, to get a response from the Supreme Court. I mean, the state's concern with waiting a week is the longer we wait, the more likely that it is that more jurors will get sick.
Correct.
Or someone else here will get sick.
Correct.
And we might end up with a retrial in the same way we would if the case were to be overturned on appeal. And
correct.
So the state's certainly strongly in favor of proceeding in this case, in one way, in one fashion or another, whether that's waiting a week, whether that's remote proceedings, or whether that's the exception from the Supreme Court in terms of the accommodation for the defendant to be in the courtroom. One way or another, the state would like to proceed.
On the other issue, Judge, we have no objection to Ms. Saucedo being released. I agreed with the court was doing earlier, but I think we're past the point where people are going to notice that she's gone or not. I'll just think she would left for COVID too. Who knows?
In terms of Ms. Saucedo, Your Honor, I think it's worth reaching out to her. The more alternates we have, the better.
Mm-hmm. How about bringing in the jurors and resting and getting at them and getting some scheduling ideas,
sir? I think that sounds good. I think what the court means by that is to see if they can extend their service next week.
So there's a psychological component to it. By them hearing the state is done with their case, and they think, okay, it's not that big of a commitment to stay on, versus bringing them back and asking them to stay on without them knowing the state is done with their presentation. Do you see what I'm saying?
And Your Honor, we certainly are willing to forego a redirect of Detective Lewis, as we mentioned earlier today. That was on the thought that there would be video proceedings or remote proceedings. If we came back next week, there would be less reason for doing so. We would just ask, if we rest today, that we have the option of bringing Detective Lewis back on rebuttal for anything to rebut the defense case.
Okay.
Well, there's not much objection if we can satisfy the defendant part of it.
You mean in the sense that he's here?
Right.
Yeah.
Then rebuttal is rebuttal. Thank you.
Lisa, can you go ahead and instant message me Ms. Salcedo's number? I believe Mr. Gonzales has his hand raised in Google Meet. I don't know if it's still up, but it was. So I don't know if you wanted to call him and see if he needs
something. Yes, he raised.
Yeah. Why don't you go ahead and call him and see if he needs something while we're waiting on this other information.
And I'll wait in my presence while I'm talking to him.
Okay, that sounds good. For the record, I just tried to call Ms. Salcedo 3 times. It went to voicemail. I mean, it just rang. So we're going to try and get her email from jury division.
And it was nothing that the court needs.
All right.
Your Honor, I did want to add one more thing in, which is, and that's relevant now since the defendant raised his hand. In terms of attorney-client communication, I think one option would be to have a Google chat going with defense counsel, and that way if the defendant has something to say, it's the same type of communication they had before, which is looking at a computer screen.
Sure.
I agree with on that part.
Yeah. So I was looking at one other case that analyzes 5612, so I'm going to take a look at that real quick while we're waiting for the GPS records, and we're back from the Supreme Court.
Back on each. I'm not going to mess with you.
waiting. I'm going to have the parties help me research this one issue. I was researching Rule 5612, and it says the defendant needs to be in person. So I was researching what's meant by in person, and if that's been changed by Supreme Court order, if in person can include remote appearance. And so I'm looking at this case, which is talking about a probation violation where the defendant appeared via remote audiovisual connection. And just a brief look at it, they're saying that this is an unreported case, but it's the Court of Appeals saying that that did not violate the defendant's right to be present. Granted, it was a probation violation, but let me give you that case and let's all kind of look into it. So this is State versus Bentley, B-E-N-T-L-E-Y. It's unreported. So it's A1-CA-39134. It reads at paragraph 11, referencing Supreme Court order. Let me give you the Supreme Court order number. Hang on, I don't want to lose what I'm just looking at. It's at paragraph 4 in the Supreme Court order. I'll give it to you in a sec. Paragraph 11 of this decision, specifically related to criminal proceedings, the order provides as well that, quote, any criminal procedure rules requiring the presence of the defendant may be accomplished through a remote audiovisual appearance in the discretion of the judge, provided that confidential communication between defendant and defense counsel is made available. So the criminal procedure rule we're talking about here is 5612 that requires the presence of the defendant. So unless there's something that specifically says that trials are excluded from that, then I think we might be able to do it. The Supreme Court order is 20-8513.
the court might distinguish that case because the order had that it was supposed to be by audiovisual unless there was an emergency need. And here it seems that it's just the opposite, that he has a right to defend himself in person unless his conduct was so disruptive.
So I'm less concerned with the holding of that case and more in the cross-reference to that Supreme Court order 20-8513, which says that paragraph 2, any criminal procedure rule requiring the presence of the defendant may be accomplished through remote audiovisual appearance at the discretion of the judge, provided that confidential communication between defendant and defense counsel is made available. So the criminal procedure rule we're talking about here, 5612, requires the presence of the defendant. And here it's saying it can be accomplished through remote means. So unless trials are specifically excluded somewhere else because the Supreme Court put out numerous rules, it's entirely possible that trials are somewhere else in here, that they're saying that that's an exception, that that can't happen, but I don't know. That's what I'm trying to find. Because I think that that paragraph of that rule would apply here.
Well, I haven't seen the whole order, but it sounds like that order was requiring audiovisual hearings.
Mm-hmm. This, any criminal procedure rule that requires the presence of the defendant, here it would be Rule 5612, may be accomplished through remote audiovisual appearance. So basically they're saying where there's the requirement in a rule for personal appearance, the judge can allow it to be audiovisual. That's how I'm reading that order.
That is what it says.
And Your Honor, that order was superseded by 20-8500-025. I don't see that 025 has been superseded on the Supreme Court's list on their website. 025, that section begins, format of court proceedings. Paragraph 1 says all hearings except for jury trial shall use telephonic or audio or video connection, court appearances. And then down at subparagraph 5, it has that same language. Any criminal procedure rule requiring the presence of the defendant.
What page is that on? I'm not finding it.
It's page 11, Your Honor, of 20-8500-025.
Okay. Paragraph 5?
Correct, Your Honor. So I don't think 5 would be necessary in addition to 1 if it didn't apply beyond.
I mean, it basically mirrors the other rule.
That's correct, Your Honor.
So paragraph 1 is saying all hearings except jury trials shall use remote means. And then at paragraph 5, it says any criminal procedure rule that requires actual presence can be accomplished through remote means.
The state agrees with Your Honor's interpretation, Your Honor.
Just got through 2 or 3 pages over here.
heard back from pretrial, and the activities of the defendant match what he represented to counsel, so I'm not going to get those records. There was nothing else.
Judge, for the record, it's our position 2585025, which does appear to be the standing order, did accept jury trials. There's some ambiguity, but we believe it should be interpreted when it said accept jury trials. Because Article 2 overrides the Supreme Court rules as to the right to defend oneself in person before a jury. Our real concern, I think, is the defendant's illness prevents his participation. It's certainly not disruptive, like I was here in not this courtroom, but this jurisdiction when David Leon Cheadle was so disruptive, he had to sit in a room up over the gallery to watch his trial. But he did that to himself. I think the court's compromise to see if jurors can extend their term in the next week. We're hoping that his condition will abate and that we'll be able to figure out a better solution than driving forward.
Let's kind of bring in the jury and let's figure out what their schedule is. For the record, we've sent an email to Ms. Salcedo, too, to see if we can get her back. All rise. You may be seated. My apologies, ladies and gentlemen, for the delay. We have been trying to figure out some options to allow us to continue today. It doesn't look like that's going to happen. So we're exploring some other options. Because what I don't want to do, what none of us want to do, is keep you past your date of service. But that may be unavoidable. I'm going to be completely honest with you. It may be unavoidable at this point. And so what I want to do is sort of discuss with you, let's go ahead and go off live stream here because I'm going to be individually addressing jurors. you have 14 left.
Not including Sausalito Judge.
Right. I'm expecting she won't be back.
Right, because there was just one that said no, is what I heard.
Right. So that leaves us with two alternates. So as far as the issue on, let's deal with it easier, what I think to be the most resolved issue at this point, and that's whether we're going to proceed with remote appearance by the defendant. Looking at Supreme Court order, the most recent one, which is 22-8518, it carves out trials specifically in that order and says that they shall be in person. This is at page 15, all criminal and civil jury trials shall proceed in person. And then it proceeds to talk about other types of hearings. And by virtue of the fact that it's shall, and they are specifically carved out in that most recent Supreme Court order, I think we're bound to in person unless the defendant waives. The defendant is not waiving. So we cannot do the remote trial. So now that leaves us with the last two options that I can think of that we've been discussing, which is bringing in one of the boxes, obviously not today, but maybe tomorrow, if the Supreme Court approves it, and we start tomorrow morning. If the Supreme Court doesn't approve it, then we go to our last plan, which is we start Wednesday of next week. And if that doesn't work, then we'll have to cross that bridge when we get there. Anything else?
No, Your Honor. Should we tell our witnesses, or can we ask the court, what should we do? We've got witnesses outside.
Let me see if I've heard anything yet. I think it got approved, the glass box idea. It's approved.
So it sounds like we'll start up at 9 o'clock tomorrow.
We'll start up at 9 o'clock tomorrow. So we'll let the jury know to come back at 9 o'clock tomorrow. In the meantime, what we're going to do is we'll get this courtroom set up, bring in one of those boxes, put an air purifier in there. You need to let Mr. Gonzales know that he needs to wear two KN95s, two of those. And he needs to come into the courthouse alone without you guys. He needs to get into the elevator alone. I'm going to talk to security and make sure that he is not associating with anybody. He's sort of making his way into the courthouse alone, elevator alone, hallway, completely isolated. Let me make sure I'm not missing anything from the proposal. We need to get him here at, let's get him here at 8:15 at the latest, and that way he is, there's not as many people coming in and out.
And Your Honor, because the defendant will be physically present, the state would like to resume its redirect of Detective Lewis.
That's fine.
My only concern is, what about if his temperature stays high, if he's got to go?
You'll just have to keep us posted, but I'm going to, hope he's going to take, medication or whatever to make him feel well enough, whether it's Tylenol or Advil or something, that he feels well enough to participate because, he's got to make some effort too.
Oh, no, so, I know that, Judge. I'm just worried. I'm just worried about his.
Right. So I'm going to assume he's going to be well enough to, be able to sit and listen to the testimony and communicate with you. So what we can do is the idea of the Google chat that Mr. Grayson has, so that you can set that up on your computer. Defense, we can have either he could do it on his phone or on a computer in his little glass box.
Yeah, I think we're going to text his cell phone to my cell
phone. Sure. Let's do that.
How does he get his cell phone in?
Well, they'll have to allow him to bring his cell phone in, I guess. But
can you let security know?
I'll do a memo to security. I'll bring it down there this afternoon, allowing him to bring his
phone. I'd ask the state, what time should we bring our witnesses? 9 doesn't make sense if they haven't rested. So
I think we'll probably just need maybe 30 minutes with Detective Lewis, so it probably does make sense to have his witnesses here at 9.
Let's have him here at 9 if they're sitting in the hallway for 30 minutes, that's okay.
Okay. Will we still have to do a directed verdict mm-hmm. after the state rests?
Yeah.
Okay. So that may take a little bit of time.
I'm inclined to explain to the jury what to expect tomorrow. Is everyone okay with that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
sure.
So that way they're not a little taken aback when they walk in, because I know they were sort of scanning the courtroom when they came in. So we'll explain what's going on. I was able to get a workaround approved so that we can continue with the trial tomorrow. So I wanted to sort of explain to you what to expect and then also to not leave you hanging about what, you know, what's going to be going on with your lives in the next week or so. You may have noticed out in the hallway there's these meeting, like little glass boxes in the hallway where there could be like an attorney-client meeting. I'm going to have one of those boxes moved into the courtroom and we're going to put it in the back over there. Mr. Gonzales will be in there. He will be double masked, two KN95s, and that way he can be present in the courtroom for the trial. But I wanted to explain that to you so that you were curious about, because I know you were sort of scanning the courtroom when you came in this afternoon, and I wanted to keep you in the loop as much as I can as far as how we're planning on moving forward. So we will resume tomorrow at 9 o'clock in the morning. If something changes before then, we will let you know before you head out, so make sure you check your phones before you leave for the courthouse. Don't plan on getting here any earlier than 9, just in case something changes and then we can't proceed tomorrow, okay? And I want to express to you all how much I appreciate your willingness to continue to stay on, and I know you have travel plans, so that's understandable, willing to stay on, your commitment to the justice system, and I know that's appreciated by all of us here. By me, by the parties, and so thank you so much for your commitment to your service. We'll see you tomorrow at 9. All right.